Please.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank organizers for so nice conference, for so nice meeting. And I'm going to speak about theory of C-symmetries, but maybe I will speak in more general context, because I believe that I will make some advertisement of crane space theory, because I think crane space theory is much more adequate, much more available for investigation in studies, investigation within pt-symmetric quantum mechanics. So in conventional quantum mechanics, we have Hilbert spaces and self-adjoint operators. But for pt-symmetric case, I think we have to use crane space theory. So my plan is, just a moment, I will give some elementary introduction, very elementary, I am so sorry, in crane space theory. Then we discuss a little bit some interpretation of basic concept of pt-symmetric quantum mechanics with the use of crane space ideas. And then we will discuss in detail the case of bounded operator C and unbounded operator C. So let's start. So some general words here. Maybe I just mention here the aim of the report is to present a mathematical reinterpretation of some underlying structures of PTQM, like PT-symmetric Hamiltonians and C-symmetry property within the crane space framework. And the main attention will be paid to the concept of C-symmetry and some different properties of operator C, like bounded and unbounded operator C. Okay, let's start definition of crane space. In order to cook crane space, we need two ingredients. We need Hilbert space, okay, this one, this fixed inner product, linear in the first argument, it does not matter. Linear in the first argument, linear in the second argument. And also we need linear operator J, which is called fundamental symmetry, if it satisfies two conditions. J squared identity operator, and J preserves the norm, preserves the scalar product. Then we may create an indefinite inner product, so scalar product and our operator J fundamental symmetry. And the Hilbert space with indefinite inner product is called the crane space. Easy. Examples, Ha standard Hilbert space, standard inner product, and J space parity operator. Then the indefinite inner product, like this one, PT inner product in terminology of PT symmetric quantum mechanics. Next, one of characteristic property of crane space that thanks to indefinite inner product, we may separate elements of our Hilbert space into three parts. Positive elements, an element is positive if indefinite matrix calculated for this element is positive, negative, and neutral. Examples of positive, negative, and neutral elements. So let's again, we will use crane space with indefinite inner product. Then subspace of even functions is positive. Subspace of odd functions, negative subspace. And example of neutral subspace is some combination between positive and negative elements, odd function and even function. So, and I forget, subspace L is positive if all non-zero elements of the subspace are positive. I consider subspace L as a subspace of our Hilbert space, so it preserves the property of Hilbert space. Okay. Why I like crane space? Because we have much more rich geometry in this space. We may consider so-called fundamental decomposition. Decomposition of our crane space into positive and negative subspaces. The sign here means these two subspaces are mutually orthogonal with respect to indefinite metric, with respect to indefinite inner product. So direct sum, two subspaces are orthogonal with respect to inner product, yot orthogonal in another terminology, equivalent terminology, and we are happy with this because in Korean space there are many fundamental decomposition such kind, and then we may define with the help of this fundamental decomposition. So we fix fundamental decomposition and we may define operator C. Bounded operator C is very easy because arbitrary element F from H can be decomposed with respect to this decomposition, and then the action of operator C is just identity operator on positive subspace at minus identity operator on negative subspace, right? And operator C, because there are many fundamental decompositions, this means there are many operator C. And operator C determine a new equivalent inner product in the Hilbert space H. So new inner product equivalent to the original one can be determined with the use of indefinite inner product and operator C. Please. Why standard inner product? Because this part is positive, this part is negative, but minus, so we have positive values. Okay. So, and in my opinion, the structure of Korean space is much more rich, flexible, if you compare it with Hilbert space structure. Why? Because if you start in Korean space, we may obtain many fundamental decomposition, then many operators C, then many new equivalent inner products on the same Hilbert space. Okay, so we have some flexibility in the choice of our inner products. Of course, if you're going to work with operator C, it's not so easy, in some concrete application, it's not so easy to construct the corresponding fundamental decomposition. We need to put many efforts to do that. But we may prove some equivalent definition of operator C. So initially, originally, we define operator C with the help of fundamental decomposition, this one. But we may prove that this definition, statement I, so operator C is determined by fundamental decomposition, but this definition is equivalent to the following definition. An operator C has the form J multiplied exponential J C, where J is fundamental symmetry of the Korean space, and Q is a bounded self-adjoint operator in our original Hilbert space, such that we have anti-commutation relation. Another equivalent definition of operator C, C squared C is mass, it should be bounded operator, such that C squared identity, and JC must be a positive operator. Positive self-adjoint operator, because C and J are positive, as bounded operators. Okay. 3 doesn't imply 2. Excuse me? What is the problem?
Two
is equivalent to three, and we have three equivalent definitions.
Where does it say anything about that?
Because
I don't see that if you know the C squared is one, that you can probably come up with a J into the
K. We can prove this in more mathematical rigorous way. So, okay. Of course, we may consider in Korean space some similar to the case of Hilbert space, we may consider some operators, special classes of operators. One of them, some generalization of self-adjoint and symmetric operators. An operator H, which is self-adjoint, is called a self-adjoint operator in Korean space if this operator is self-adjoint with respect to indefinite inner product. So in this operator, in that case, is called J self-adjoint or J symmetric. Let me explain these two things, because if H is J self-adjoint, this means This operator is self-adjoint with respect to indefinite inner product, and this property is equivalent to this condition. Okay, but I'm afraid maybe there are some misunderstandings sometimes here, because J-symmetric in our context means just this relation. It does not mean that J-symmetric, it does not mean that J it does not mean this property, but mean exactly this relation. Okay, but of course we consider more wider class of operator, and of course we lose little bit in spectral properties if you compare with the case of self-adjoint operator. So in contrast to self-adjoint operators, the spectra of J self-adjoint operators are just symmetric with respect to a real axis. As to other spectral properties, everything might happen.
Oh. In the second line, you refer to the domains of the relevant operator J and itself.
This one, of course. Yeah. This means from domain. Yeah, indeed, we have to consider operator with domain of operator, and I will use this symbol for domain of operator H. Okay, so for any fj for domain of H, we have this relation. Some standard generalization of standard symmetric operator in Hilbert space structure. Okay, and some examples. AIXQRET operator with domain of definition is P self-adjoint in space L to R. But if you consider the same operator with domain of definition, for example, the linear span of all eigenvalues, we know that this operator has a complex set of eigenfunctions, with linear span of eigenfunctions here, and another possible domain of definition, infinitely differentiable functions with compact support. These two operators are P-symmetric, no P-self-adjoint. P-self-adjoint is more particular case. P-symmetric is more general case. These operators are P-symmetric in our space. So the property of H being P-self-adjoint or P-symmetric depends on the choice of domain of definition, nothing else. Okay, and some collection of books devoted to crane space theory. Okay. Of course, some trivial things about PT-symmetric quantum mechanics. Why real spectrum for this operator? Condition of PT-symmetry. Because formally, I like this word here, because formally means we don't think about domain of definition. Yeah, formally PT-symmetric. And this gave rise to some pseudo-Hermitian extension of standard quantum mechanics. One of main objects of new PT-symmetric quantum mechanics are PT-symmetric operators. And I would like to mention that it's very easy to define PT-symmetry in an abstract Hilbert space. It's very easy because P, we know from previous examples that P space parity operator in L to R, for example. But this means P is a fundamental symmetry, satisfies the definition of fundamental symmetry. So our space operator is fundamental symmetry in the space L2, okay, because P squared identity operator, and of course we may check product. Yeah. So instead of fixed, except of space parity operator, we may consider arbitrary operator fundamental symmetry. Arbitrary fundamental symmetry in our abstract Hilbert space, and T is the operator of conjugation. So what does it mean, operator of conjugation? T squared identity, and slightly different properties because we have obtained different ordering of F and J, complex conjugation. Also, we need to assume the commutation relation because in standard PT, P commutes with T. So we assume that PT is equal to TP, and operator H is called PT symmetric if we have this relation, of course, for any element F from domain of definition of operator H. It's very easy to generalize the concept of PT symmetric operator on abstract case. And now maybe, the definition, but I would like to say that the definition of PT symmetry is quite general, very general, and the set of PT symmetric operator contains operator with is very, very various spectral properties. For example, let's consider some marginal case. So we consider this operator on real line, and this operator with epsilon is equal to 2 is in the limit so-called case at plus minus infinity. So this means such kind of operator, if you're going to consider it on real line instead of complex plane, and its adjoint are PT symmetric, but the spectrum of this operator coincides with complex plane and non-real points belongs to the point spectrum of H. And the residual spectrum belongs to this adjoint operator. I have in mind that non-real part of a real line belongs to residual spectrum, operator H adjoint. So we have some troubles with PT symmetric operators, if you will consider the general class of symmetric operators. But another example, I was motivated by talk by Philip, by lecture Philip, because we may prove some mathematical rigorous way that every self-adjoint operator H acting in separable Hilbert space Ha is a PT symmetric operator for some suitable choice of P and T. And examples of some explicit construction were presented yesterday in your lecture. But, for example, maximal dissipative operator and symmetric operators with different defect indices cannot be PT symmetric. Okay. Maybe this is one crucial point. In the majority of cases, I wrote here in the majority of cases, but I don't know any example. I don't know any example when, if you will start from PT symmetric operator, as this operator cannot be symmetric in some suitable choice of Kreyn space. So I don't know such kind of example, but maybe there are such kind of examples because I use it here in the majority of cases. PT symmetric operators can be interpreted, realized as J self-adjoint operator or J symmetric operators in a Kreyn space. So we start from PT symmetric operators, but we believe that any operator of such kind can be realized PT symmetric, but this operator can be realized or J self-adjoint or J symmetric operator. So this condition allows us to investigate PT symmetric operator within the Kreyn space structure.
That is true if regardless of whether H has a broken PT symmetry or an unbroken?
For any cases, I don't know examples. If you will start from PT symmetric operator, if you will fix PT symmetric operator, and I believe that every PT symmetric operator can be realized as J self-adjoint or J symmetric. It does not depend on the property of PT symmetry be unbroken or broken.
That's very interesting.
But
is P linear?
Yeah, of course.
That's
P.
That's
It's very important because in our generalization, of course, we consider P arbitrary fundamental symmetry. This means P linear operator, and J T must be anti-linear because we have some changes here. Okay. So this is an open problem because I don't know examples. Okay. But now maybe We may generalize the concept of operator C, which of course we may find in PT-symmetric quantum mechanics. I just repeat some standard statements from PTQM. So PT-symmetric operator can be realized Hamiltonian PTQ if there exists operator C such that C squared identity, okay, this condition, because operator PT-symmetric, and commutation with H, and what is very, very important, and H turns out to be self-adjoint with respect to new inner product, CPT inner product, this way. So this means if we catch operator C in PTQM, we may construct with the help of this operator new inner product. Yeah. And if you look at this expression, we may see that C multiplied by P must be positive self-adjoint operator. But now let's check our definition of operator C, which comes from Crane space theory. Bounded operator, C squared identity, and of course, it does not matter. Fundamental symmetry here on the right-hand side or left-hand side. And JC is a positive self-adjoint operator in this case because bounded operator we have. Okay, so the conditions 3 coincide with standard interpretation of PT of operator C in PT symmetric quantum mechanics. So, but this means we may define operator C. We may define the property of operator C. A linear density defined operator H in our space has a property of bounded operator C, the property of bounded C symmetry. If there exists a bounded operator C, I use it here another equivalent definition of operator C. If there exists a bounded operator C in this form, J multiplied exponential function Q, with the properties described above. So, with the properties described above means instead of assertion 3, I use it here equivalent definition 2. But it does not matter. We can use first one, second one, third one, because this definition are equivalent. Okay. So we define the property of bounded C symmetry for a linear density operator acting in an Hilbert space. Okay, of course, a commutation relation. I forget about commutation relation. Yeah. This case is very simple because it's a bounded operator C, and description of C symmetry of J self-adjoint J symmetric operator is equivalent to explicit construction of the metric operator, which ensures the self-adjointness, the symmetricity, depends on the types of our operators. J self-adjoint means after the renormalization, we will obtain the self-adjointness, standard self-adjointness operator, and symmetricity for the case of J symmetric operator with respect to the new inner product. Okay, so maybe additional comment to this part, because in our Hilbert space, we may consider many equivalent new inner products. If you take into account the definition of inner product, we may rewrite it as metric operator where Q is bounded self-adjoint operator. Q is bounded joint operator. So this one is a general collection of all possible equivalent inner products. So we may parameterize it with the help of such kind of metric operators. But if you use Crane space structure, okay, then we construct operator C, and then we construct with the help of operator C, equivalent inner products, the same form, but with the additional condition that Q j must be minus jq. So inner products which arise after under the choice of operator C can be selected from this general class with the help of this additional condition, anti-commutation relation with fundamental symmetry. Okay, why we need such kind of results? Because the theorem H B J self-adjoint, then H turns out to be self-adjoint by a suitable choice of new inner product. Here we means suitable choice arbitrary inner product, so this arbitrary metric operator. Then, if and only if H has the property of bounded C-symmetry, and the required inner product can be chosen as inner product generated by operator C. So from this point of view, if you will consider the case of J self-adjoint operator, then for the solution of the problem of similarity, we don't need to consider the general collection of all possible metric operators, and it's sufficient for us to restrict our attention just inner products which can be generated with the help of operators bounded C-symmetry. Okay. Next. Of course, but this case, as this definition, does not take into account the property of PT symmetry. We need to input this property in the general theory, and let's do that. Definition. Let H be a PT symmetric operator, and let H be J symmetric. So we believe that this operator, by the way, typically, if you start from PT symmetric operator, we obtain realization H as P symmetric operator. So fundamental symmetry from this comes to this fundamental symmetry. But there are examples for PT symmetric operators which admits realization with the use of other different fundamental symmetries J, which don't coincide with P. It's just a remark. I will illustrate this property maybe next pages, and we'll say that H has unbroken C symmetry if H has a property of C symmetry in the sense of our previous definitions, and additional condition, this operator C must be PT symmetric. It's a standard definition. And then, of course, our previous equivalent definition of operator C, we a little bit modify because additional condition, and for the first one, when operator C is determined by decomposition, positive and negative subspace. But this means unbroken C symmetry means that subspaces L plus minus must be PT invariant. Second condition, modification of second condition, of course, Q, self-adjoint operator, must commute with PT. And this one, we assume that S is a bounded PT symmetric operator. So some modification of our definition that we may apply for the case of PT symmetric operator, some specific class of C operators which admits, which possess additional property of commutation with PT, this one. Okay, and I would like to say that indeed, the condition of PT symmetry imposed on our operator C leads to very, very essential simplification of the corresponding formulas. Let me illustrate this fact. It's some toy model. So, space A2, fundamental symmetry, matrix Pauli, tau standard operator, T standard operator of complex conjugation is S2. Okay. First of all, we're going to describe all possible PT symmetric fundamental symmetries, because, of course, one of these fundamental symmetry coincides with P, but maybe there are another fundamental symmetries. And we may show that PT symmetric non-trivial fundamental symmetry has the form P multiplied by this function when psi is an arbitrary real number. So we have some rotation, our operator P, with the use of matrix Pauli here. And we may consider arbitrary non-trivial fundamental symmetry of this form. And with the help of this fundamental symmetry, we may define Krein space with the indefinite inner product. Okay. I like this indefinite inner product because they preserve the conjugation profile of PT. Okay. And next, an arbitrary operator C acting in this space has the form according to our definition, because this space, Krein space, is defined via fundamental symmetry. Okay, this one. Then operator C must be P psi multiplied by exponential function Q, where Q is self-adjoint operator which anti-commutes with P psi. Some small analysis leads to the conclusion that it's a general form for operator C acting in our space. It looks sufficiently cumbersome, very complicated from my point of view. But if we will add the additional condition of PT symmetry of C, C is assumed to be PT symmetric, then this long relation immediately can be rewritten as follows. So it's very easy. Let's compare. Okay. Next step. Let H be an operator matrix in our space A2. We decompose this matrix H with respect to matrices Pauli and identity matrix. Okay. Then H is PT symmetric if and only if the corresponding coefficients appearing here satisfy this condition. Okay. Any PT symmetric operator from the first line is PF self-adjoint, where the parameter psi is determined by this relation. So this means if you start from the general operator PT symmetric operator, then for realization of this operator as a P self-adjoint P symmetric operator in Krein space, we need different fundamental symmetries and real parameter C from here is determined by this relation H1, H2. And if this condition is satisfied, our operator H, we know that this operator PT symmetric, then next step, this operator is P psi self-adjoint, and then for this operator we may construct unique unbroken C-symmetry. Please look. So it's
that's unique. So it's unique.
Yeah, of course.
There's no other C.
Yeah. For our operator, of course, for our operator H. Operator. Yeah.
Yes,
because the general formula, this one, and here we have two additional parameters, psi and C. Okay? And then psi is determined by this expression. And psi is determined by this expression, and xi, we may calculate it. There is some corresponding formulas with the help of some relation between trace our matrix H and determinant of our matrix. It's easy.
That's unique because this is a 2x2?
Yes, of course. Yeah, but we may consider, I believe at least, we may consider in my lecture more interesting examples of unique operator C. And maybe typically, if operator C is bounded, this operator must be unique. Okay, I'm going to truly stress this fact because maybe it's my principal point of my, crucial point of my lecture.
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
If instead of a 2x2 matrix, if you had a 4x4, but. By two, and then it was blocked diagonal. Okay, so you had a 2x2 and then another.
Yeah.
Would C still be unique?
In general case, maybe no. In general case, maybe no. You may find some. Maybe some non-trivial collaboration between these two parts.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's consider this case, because it was motivated by a recent paper by Krajicerik and Siegel. We may consider a J-symmetric operator H with a complete set of eigenvectors. Complete set means the linear span of eigenvectors is a denser subset in HK. And we assume that these eigenvectors correspond to real eigenvalues. Okay. For the simplicity, the geometric multiplicity of the corresponding eigenvalues is identity, that is. So, in that case, it's very, very easy to prove because our operator is J-symmetric operator. So, is this operator possess some right, good properties with respect to indefinite inner product? We may prove that eigenvectors are mutually J orthogonal. Of course, it's very, very expected results, similar to self-adjoint operator, similar to symmetric operator. And moreover, it's a very, very important fact. If Fn is an eigenvalue, is eigenfunction, excuse me, then Fn, Fn, and definite inner product cannot be zero, cannot vanish, cannot vanish. And also, it's very easy to prove that algebraic multiplicity of eigenvalues is identity. So lambda n is a simple eigenvalues in any cases of J-symmetric operator with complex set of eigenvectors, we may claim that these eigenvectors are mutually J-orthogonal and this condition is satisfied. But thanks to this condition, we may separate our eigenfunctions as positive, negative, by the sign. We may separate by the sign positive, negative eigenvectors, and then we may consider positive and negative subspace in our Kronian space as a closure of corresponding sets of positive and negative eigenvectors. And by the construction, this J-orthogonal positive and negative subspaces in Kronian space forms the direct sum. And this direct sum is a denser set in H. Why a denser set in H? Because we assume that our set of eigenvectors is a complex set. So this means must be dense set. Okay, let's assume that H be a U-symmetric operator with complex set of normalized eigenvectors corresponding to real simple eigenvectors. Then the following assertions are equivalent. The set of eigenvectors forms a Ries basis in H. Okay, the operator H is equivalent to conditions. The operator H has a property of C-symmetry. And moreover, this operator of C-symmetry is determined uniquely. It's a unique operator C for this case. And this operator C is constructed as follows. Very easy. Okay. But it's some trivial case of Ries basis of eigenfunctions. But many operators C appearing in literature unbounded. What we can do in this case? We need some generalization of our concept of bounded operator C to the case of unbounded operator C. Let's check what we know about bounded operator C in Kronian space setting. The bounded operator C are in one-to-one correspondence with the fundamental decomposition, because due to our definition of operator C, decomposition of our Kronian space onto positive and negative subspaces. The subspaces L plus and might have two characteristic properties. They are maximal. It's very, very important properties. I going to pay your attention. They are maximal in the corresponding classes of positive and negative subspaces. So this means there are no more bigger subspaces which possess the property to be a positive or negative subspaces. Maximal subspace in the corresponding classes of operator. And inner products, considered respectively at L plus and L minus, are equivalent to the initial inner product. So this is a case of bounded operator C. Let's assume that our subspace L plus L minus has the property A only, maximal, but we lose the property B. So now we does not assume that new inner products are equivalent to original scalar product. In that case, due to the general statement of Kronian space theory, we may claim that maximal subspaces L plus L minus are orthogonal with respect to indefinite metric form a dense set in our Cranes space. So this Dirac sum does not coincide with the space Ha. Just a dense subset of Cranes space Ha. And then, but we may use this decomposition for the formal definition of operator C. For the formal definition of operator C in the same way. Decomposition on positive and negative eigenfunctions, positive and negative elements, and then operator C acts. I just repeat previous definition from bounded case. And equivalent definition of C. Operator C has the form. It's something similar to the bounded operator, but here Q is unbounded self-adjoint operator. The difference is unbounded. Before, in previous case, we have bounded operator Q, such that commutation relation is satisfied. Equivalent definition, C is unbounded operator, such that C squared identity for all F, but not for all elements from our Hilbert space, just for all F from this dense subset. And J, S have to be a positive self-adjoint operators. Properties of C. In this case, if you will define such kind of unbounded operator C, this operator is unbounded, closed J self-adjoint operator, defined just on the domain of definition, on this direct sum, not for all elements of a Hilbert space. The point spectrum of C coincides with minus 1, 1, but the continuous spectrum coincides with the rest of complex plane. This appearance of continuous spectrum does not relate to some inherent structure, best structure of C, but rather indicates the wrong choice of Hilbert space Ha, wrong choice of initial scalar product. Okay, very, very quickly, because 15 minutes. Density defined operator H has the property of unbounded C symmetry if there exists a linear unbounded operator C. I just repeat definition for bounded operator C, such that the commutation relation is satisfied. Formally, the definition of unbounded C-symmetry coincides with the definition of bounded C-symmetry because very, very small difference. The commutation relation decomposes our operator in the direct sum and we are happy. But this is formally. However, there is a principal difference. Existence of unbounded C-symmetry for adjacent self-adjoint operator H leads to a confusing conclusion that all non-real points belong to the continuous spectrum of H. We can prove this mathematically rigorous. Therefore, there are no unbounded C symmetries for J self-adjoint operators with discrete spectrum. Okay, so some kind of negative result. But this result may seem paradoxical only at the first glance. Because unboundedness of C gives us some information about the wrong choice of underlying Gilbert space that is expressed via the appearance of continuous spectrum. Okay. But J self-adjointness of H is established in accordance with unfriendly inner product. So this means that H is closed with respect to our original inner product, but this property does not fit the singular inner product which constructs with the help of operator C. So it's very, very natural that this, in this case, appear continuous spectrum, and as a result of such consistency, the non-real continuous spectrum arises. But, summing up, we don't need, for the case of unbounded operator C, we don't need to consider J self-adjoint operators because we consider this operator in accordance with the wrong choice of our previously chosen Hilbert space. We need to consider J-symmetric operators instead of J-self-adjoint ones. It's very natural. Okay. And let's consider what happens in this case. J-symmetric operator, this complex set of eigenvectors corresponding to real eigenvectors. So I just repeat my previous example, but and I just mentioned that this condition means the simplicity of eigenvalues. If Fn are normalized, we can assume that then the Biot-orthogonal system Jn is defined uniquely. Biot-orthogonal system means that we have such kind of relation. Okay. And now let's assume that Fn collection, the set of eigenfactors, forms a Schauder basis, not Ries basis, Schauder basis. Good news. Because Schauder basis, we may consider F as a decomposition with respect to our eigenvectors, and these coefficients are determined uniquely. And very nice, the sequences Fn is almost normalized. We can prove this mathematically rigorously. There exists a positive constant M capital such that you have such capital. So this is a good news. But bad news. I am so sorry that.
But you gave us the good first.
Yeah, of course. Bad news. But news means we don't need to consider this operator in our previously chosen Hilbert space H. What we lose? Unfortunately, the basis Fn is conditional. I hate this condition because this means there exists a permutation such that after the permutation, our collection cannot be a basis. I don't understand, is it possible to realize in some physical way, because it's crazy.
So it's sort of like a conditionally convergent series, is that
what you're saying? Yeah, but...
You permute the terms in the series, then you can change the sum of the series.
Yeah, but... Yeah, but from my point of view, if you consider some states in Hilbert space, that all states have equal rights.
Yeah.
But here, we need to choose some ordering.
You have to do an infinite permutation, right?
Yeah, of course. Okay. Of course, infinite permutation, yeah.
It wouldn't matter.
Yeah. And next, bad news. Sequence Fn cannot be Bessel sequence. Some definition of Bessel sequence and cannot be a Hilbert sequence. Definition of Hilbert sequence here. I skip this explanation. Just a remark that such kind of properties are very, very useful in frame theory, in wavelet theory. But unfortunately, we lose these properties. Conclusion. It's not easy to work with Schauder basis of eigenfunctions of J-symmetric operator in the original Hilbert space H, because almost all useful properties of the Ries basis, unconditionally Bessel and Hilbert properties, are lost. So, what we have to do? We need to ask help, crazy space theory. Okay, let's continue our investigation. If Fn is a Schauder basis, okay, then the subspace, but we may separate our eigenfunctions by the sign. We may separate onto the positive and the negative subspaces, and thanks to property of Fn being Schauder basis, we can prove that such kind of subspace are maximal. Then the direct sum of such kind determines an unbounded operator C, and this operator can be determined uniquely. Unbounded operator, which will be determined uniquely thanks to property of Fn to be a Schauder basis, gives a conclusion that L plus L minus are maximal, but maximal direct sum of maximal subspace determines an unbounded operator, and this operator must be unique. And some result. Schauder operator, defined unique unbounded operator of this form. This operator is unbounded, closed, and J self-adjoint. The metric operator is a positive self-adjoint operator in H. So we improve the situation here with the help of our unbounded operator C, but I believe that this case is very boring. Why? Let me explain. If we choose a unique operator C, then we may construct the corresponding singular inner product, which gives rise to new Hilbert space, which does not coincide with the initial Hilbert space H, because new inner product is singular with respect to original inner product, and then the subspace L plus H is the quasi of L plus with respect to new singular inner product, subspace L minus is the quasi of L minus with respect to minus indefinite inner product. Okay, and theorem, let H be a J-symmetric operator. We don't need here J self-adjoint operator. J-symmetric operator with a simple eigenvalues and with simple eigenvalues, which forms a Schauder basis. If H has a property of C-symmetry, then the corresponding operator C is determined uniquely, and it coincides with this form. And H, this operator, of course, is unbounded, and H turns out to be essentially a self-adjoint operator in the new Hilbert space. I find this example boring because here we also have some renormalization, maybe new Hilbert space, but it's really wrapped as the same with the choice of the corresponding new singular inner product. But the result is the same. The case is equivalent to the Ries basis case. But if you consider this I self-adjoint PT symmetric operator, this operator is PT symmetric L2, and it has real simple eigenvalues, and the corresponding eigenfunctions forms a complex set. We know these facts. Yeah. But I believe the results of these papers was established that there are many unbounded operators for operator C. But the question is, contradicts to our theory or no? What do you prefer? No contradicts. Because it just means that our complex set of eigenfunctions for this operator cannot be a Ries basis, since operator C constructed in these papers are unbounded, okay? And this complex set of eigenfunctions cannot be a Schrödinger basis.
So what is it?
So, it's much more deeper structure. Okay. But next troubles with complex set of eigenfunctions. Similar to the previous cases, we can separate the eigenfunctions. We can do that, right? Construct the positive and negative subspaces. Okay, right. Consider Dirac sum, which is a denser set, and define the operator C in a similar way. But what we lost? We lost the maximality. Because we have Schrödinger basis. In this case, operator L, subspaces L plus and L minus turns out to be maximal. But here, we lost the maximality of our subspace, and this means the Dirac sum cannot be used for explicit definition of operator C. And by the way, we may repeat formally the definition of operator C from our previous case, the case of Schrödinger basis, but this operator is unbounded, closed, but it cannot be J self-adjoint. This means the metric operator, which construct with the help of this our decomposition, and in other words, construct with the help of eigenfunctions Fn, metric operator is a positive, closed, unbounded symmetric operator. It's a very, very important difference, symmetric operator. And this metric operator cannot be self-adjoint operator. But I checked many textbooks and looking on definition of metric operator. In any cases, we assume that this operator, metric operator, in any definition, we assume that this metric operator should be self-adjoint. But here, this operator, we cannot say that this operator is a metric operator. It's wrong here. This operator is positive, closed, unbounded symmetric operator. We can use them as a metric operator just in the case when this operator turns out to be self-adjoint. So now we have some meeting with new branch of mathematics, extension theory of symmetric operators. And just conclusion and open problems. To properly define the operator C, we need to construct the extension of the symmetric operator, this one symmetric operator, okay, which expresses it directly in terms of Bersonne normal sequences of Jn. It's typically for the definition of metric operator. But we need to construct the extension of this symmetric operator to a positive self-adjoint operator J in L2 with the additional condition. This additional condition just means that the corresponding operator C, after the construction, the corresponding operator C must satisfy the condition C squared identity operator. So it's some very technical condition. We cannot see this condition. So, but there are many self-adjoint extension of G symmetric operator. There are many unbounded operator C. So the papers devoted to this Hamiltonian corresponds to the case of complex set of eigenfunctions which cannot be raised by this, cannot be sheltered by this. And in this case, indeed, there are many, many unbounded operators C. But maybe some strange conclusion. Let's look on operator C and let's look at this operator, symmetric operator. This operator is determined exactly in terms of our eigenfunctions. Yeah? There's no system to a collection of eigenfunctions, but very easy to calculate what does it mean, Jn. Sine, indefinite in the product, P, Fn. So, roughly speaking, this operator constructed explicitly with the help of eigenfunctions. Yeah? But we can consider it as a satisfactory in our case. So, is the information which gives us eigenfunction, system of eigenfunctions, cannot be satisfactory for our cases. Because we made some extension to self-adjoint operator, but this means we need to extend the domain of definition of our operator. So we will add new vectors from the domain of definition of adjoint. So this means in order to construct this unbounded operator C, we need to put in additional information which does not relate directly with the collection of eigenfunctions. Oops. And the possibility, maybe some small comment, the possibility to apply well-developed methods of the extension theory of symmetric operator. We consider our operator, and according to general statements of extension theory of symmetric operators, there exist extremal positive self-adjoint extensions, hard E. Friedrichs extensions, and soft Crane von Neumann extension. And let J be arbitrary positive self-adjoint extension of our operator. Then we have such relation, such inequalities. So the choice and these equalities can be expressed in terms of quadratic forms. And this means, and in terms of operators also, okay. And this means if you will choose self-adjoint extension, for example, Friedrichs extension or Crane extension, yeah, we obtain a metric operator. But this metric operator, which corresponds to these two different cases, cannot be equivalent. So in that case, we obtain why I talk that this case, Schauder basis, is boring. Because here we make just a normalization without some new deep insights. But when we will consider operators something like that, this means that for the construction of right operator C, we need to input some additional information. And the question is, we may do this in different ways, non-equivalent ways. And so this means different non-equivalent completion of our original denser set. So
that means that this theory it's new, it's different from
of course,
conventional
it's much more deeper. It's much more deeper.
Jeez.
Thank you.
Yes. So, hi. Does that imply the completeness of the eigen
vectors?
Was proved.
Yeah. By the way, for this part, without local coordinates, it was proved by Krejcik and Siegel. But maybe some is not a good point in this paper because they consider the case of J P self-adjoint operator, this immediately means troubles because we consider a completion of our original Hamiltonian, which is, from my point of view, we have to consider this operator on linear span of eigenfunctions, right? And then if you're going to work in original space, you have to do a completion with respect to, but with respect to this bad inner product.
Right.
So this means problem which was indicated in this paper. We don't need to consider J self-adjoint operator for the case of unbounded operator C. We need to consider P-symmetric, and I like this condition because in order to prove that operator is P self-adjoint, we need to establish a relation, some kind. It's a big walk, because here we need to construct a joint operator and check this relation for any function f from domain of definition of H. But instead, for the case of P symmetric operator, what we need to do? We just need to check. It's easy, extremely easy.
Slide number one,
number one.
You remember what was slide number one?
The one which had the positive noise, the zero. Very good. That I agree with that one. That's good. I agree with that one. Keep going. There. Now then, the prime space is defined with the positive norm and the negative norm or the neutral norm.
No. Okay.
We'll forget the neutral. Now, that only occurs in PT symmetries where the eigenvalues are real. In cases where the eigenvalues have been complex pairs, the only non-vanishing norms are between the two opposite members of the complex conjugate pair. There are no diagonal elements. So it's not a crime space. That's what I was asking earlier on. This is okay for
real life, yeah.
This is okay for unbroken PT. It doesn't describe the complex conjugate case.
Maybe I may explain. We may define crane space in any case because here we just fix fundamental symmetry.
Yeah.
Anything else? Yeah. Okay. We may consider some. We may consider these operators in this space. We may consider new operators with some unusual spectral properties because arbitrary J self-adjoint operators possess a spectrum which is symmetric with respect to real line. Yeah, and eigenfunctions here, plus f or minus. Indeed, in this case, the undefined inner product. This eigenfunction is zero.
Yeah.
But if you will consider the direct sum of these two eigenfunctions, so eigenfunctions and conjugated eigenfunctions, okay?
Yeah,
it's exactly what you say.
Yes, but the conjugated eigenfunction is not related to the original one by a linear transformation, it's related by an antilinear transformation. You can't use an operator J the way you've been using it unless J is antilinear. Because you have to flip the sign.
We don't consider here antilinear operators, it seems to me. And if you will consider these two eigenfunctions,
yes.
We obtain, and we just restrict our attention to these two eigenfunctions, we obtain new inner product, yes. H1, with one positive part and one negative part.
That's correct.
Yeah. Maybe
F1, that's the ordinary inner product.
You want
to define a generalized inner product, you have to take F1 to be the PT, the F1 bra to be the PT conjugate of F1 ket.
But
that was my only comment.
Let me show. But this is correct. Maybe the question is, I assume that my inner product is linear with respect to the first argument.
You're assuming it's linear on both sides.
Yeah, but it's just rewrite the definition.
Whether you can assume that if you have a broken PT symmetry.
Yeah.
That's all. If you just look at the 2x2 case, what happens is that if you change the parameter, if you just naively
change the parameter and go into the broken PT symmetric region, what you find is that the statement of orthogonality reverses. F1 is orthogonal to F1, and F2 is orthogonal to F2, but F1 is not orthogonal.
Yeah, of course, it depends.
But it may be wrong to do that naive analytic continuation.
But it depends on the choice of concrete example. But here, we just introduce a very standard structure, because here we don't consider the region of broken or unbroken PT symmetry. It's just a definition of Krein space. Yeah, the problem maybe appear at next page, when I believe that.
That's right. You're assuming no neutral.
Yeah.
Right. You threw out the neutral and you kept only the positive.
Yeah, but.
Well, you just can't have it over here.
Yeah. But okay, I agree. But in that case, okay. It's easy to explain because. In typical cases like that, we have that F2 coincides with J F1, linear operator, linear.
No, it has to be an anti-linear.
Okay. It does not matter, but I'm going to show that if you consider this, okay, for J self-adjoint operator, J self-adjoint operator, if you will have two eigenfunctions which are symmetric with respect to each other, this is some result from textbooks, okay? Then in that cases, F1 of course has a neutral, F2 neutral, but when we will consider linear sum, linear span of these two. And
it's a very simple construction, I think. Remember just black holes and light cone coordinates. It's the same effect when you're passing the horizon, you're going to light cone coordinates, and then you have this other combination which is giving you this inner product.
Yeah, it's just standard claims from textbooks, because in that case, we obtain after the linear combination, after the linear span, we obtain new. We obtain some realization of Krein space structure. So I understand this looks very strange, but the question, the problem, maybe the point is, if F1, there are big troubles here, because indeed in this case, the linear combination gives us a neutral indefinite norm for any linear combination. But for J self-adjoint operators, we may prove that this indefinite inner product cannot be zero. And then some standard arguments from textbooks show us that indeed in this case we obtain Krein space. We may discuss this later if you want.
No, but the okay.